This week we'll cover the chapter 8, and chapter 8 is generally shows the experimental data to describe the effect of soil parameters, soil condition on the wave velocity and attenuation. Could be a P and a S wave. The contents is as follow. Here that we're gonna review the properties of like continuous media, like PA velocity and attenuation, general range. We'll review the general range of the PA velocity and the PA attenuation of continuous media. And then we'll see the effect of saturation. So this might be very helpful for your report, for the project report. And we'll see the effect of isotropic stress and anisotropy and the strain effect. And we'll see the effect of electrical interactions, cementation, and the creep effect, and then we're done. And mostly, this chapter puts emphasis on the S-wave propagation, because shear wave reflects the granular skeletal speed stiffness and their property, right? So here we'll have more data on the S-wave velocity and the S-wave attenuation. So this is a this table shows the velocity of the various material. Like, let's look at the numbers. Here, air, the PA velocity of the air is about 340 meter per sec. So this is the sound speed, right? And pure water has about 1500 meter per second, right? 1480 meter per second. And seawater is a little bit larger than pure water. And also this PA velocity varies with temperature, right? It changes with temperature. So to get the exact velocity, you have to know your own temperature and salinity. Then you can calculate. I think there are tons of data showing the PA velocity of water with the different chemical and different temperature and different pressure too. So you can look it up for it. And benzene, oil, glycerin is all above the 1000 meter per sec. And this is the rock mineral, right? And you can see that it's about like 5000, 6000, 7000, and 8000 meter per second. And here is the density. Interestingly, the pyrite has the largest density. And what is pyrite? So I think a calcite is made of calcium and carbonate. Quartz is silica based, right? SiO2, silicon dioxide. Feldspar also silica based mineral. Salt is sodium chloride. And pyrite is iron, is based on the iron and sulfide, iron sulfide. So because of this iron, it has a large density. And limestone, sandstone, and granite, and the PA velocity is about like 4,000, 2,000, and shale, you can see it's the smallest because it's made of clay, and 2,000 meter per second, and you have the density, and impedance is what? Impedance is density times velocity, right? And here we have the data for soil, granular salt to 200 meter per second, dry sand 100 to 200 meter per second, clay is about the range, right? And impedance is much less than the rock mineral, and there are some metal value here, 5,000, 6,000 meter per second, density is much larger than that. Right, 9 and 8, 11, so that you can see the impedance, comparing to the impedance of the soil, you see that this is much larger than this one. So, for example, when you do the RCTS, resonant column test, then you have a free boundary at the top and bottom, you have a fixed end with the, maybe the bottom plate is made of steel, so that you have very big mismatch in the impedance. So steel is typically used for the to achieve the fixed condition. So this is the big attenuation value, the Q. So attenuation value is in general inverse Q. And inverse Q is about 2D. And here the air, and aluminum has very high Q, right? And what about the water? Where is the water? Water is really high Q. High Q value. So high Q material means that you have very low loss. Energy loss is very small, right? So the attenuation is small. And rock is about 100 sometimes. So shale has very low Q. So that means it has very high attenuation, right? It will lose the energy very fast. And granite, sand is about this value. So if you calculate the damping at very small strain, how much would that be? If the Q is about 100, what would be the damping? 1 over Q is D. So then D is about 2D, sorry, 2D. So then D is 1 over 2Q, right? Then you can plug this Q value here. When the Q value is about 100, the damping is about 얼마인가요? 0.005. So if you multiply 100, then you get the percent value, right? Then that's about 0.5%, right? So 0.5%. So here, this is around like 0.3 to 0.6% in the case of sand, the dry sand and the saturated sand. And saturated clay is much lower Q. So that means it has high damping ratio. That's about 1 to 3%. Just to be aware of the general range of the attenuation value. Okay. Okay, then next, we'll see the effect of degree of saturation. And sorry, so we have derived this equation, right? This is a simplified version of the Gassmann equation. So the period velocity is function of what? Constraint modulus of skeleton and fluid bulk modulus and the total density. So, in the fluid bulk modulus, you have a parameter water bulk modulus and grain bulk modulus, and this is N is the porosity, right? And this can be also changed as function of S and BW and air. So you can see that if it's saturated, sorry, if it's saturated, the period velocity is primarily controlled by bulk modulus of the fluid and the porosity and the grain bulk modulus. So then let's see the effect of porosity first. So here we have a PA velocity of the soil and the PA velocity of the fluid. Then you can derive this equation. Fluid PA velocity is very simple. So you have VP fluid, because we are assuming that this is a fully saturated condition, so this will be just a BW over rho W. And this is not the shear, sorry, the constraint modulus. Why is bulk modulus?철안. Why we are using just water bulk modulus here? No, we are talking about the PA velocity of water. Just pure water. Why not constraint modulus? Originally, the pH velocity is constraint modulus of the continuum media over this density, right? Then why we are just using bulk modulus here? And m is b plus 4 over 3 g, right? G is the shear modulus, right? Because shear modulus of water is 0, right? So that we can simplify, right? Right here. 너무 쉬워가지고 대답을 못한 거죠? 아, 내 질문을 잘못해서 그래요. 아무튼. So we can come up with this equation at the second equation. Then if you plot it against the velocity, when the velocity changes from 0 to 1, so here 0 means that you have a fully cemented solid, right? Velocity 0 means that you don't have any pore, right? And here 1 means that you have 100% pore, so you don't have any solid. So then it changes, the ratio ranges from 1 to 2, but sometime at some point it goes to minimum value that's below than 1. But when you calculate the impedance, it doesn't go below than 1. Right? So you have the water, and this is the seabed. When you shoot the P wave to exploration, seismic exploration, always the impedance of the fluid is less than the soil. So this one will be always, soil has higher impedance always. Huh? And when you have the air, so now before we've been talking about the fully saturated condition, when the degree of saturation is 100%, and now we are relaxing the water saturation, and when you have air, even though it's very small amount, so this is like 0.1%, you have significant reduction in bulk modulus, right? So we have done this before. So then, because the bulk modulus is significantly reduced, the pH velocity will be really small, right? So then pH velocity of unsaturated soil is mostly governed by skeletal stiffness rather than the fluid stiffness. Okay. So if you plug that here the water bulk modulus will change, right? So this will be what? Degree of saturation and air bulk modulus and water bulk modulus, right? Then you can see the pH velocity stays at below than 1000 meters per second. And when the degree of saturation is approached to 100, you have sudden increase like this. How much is the water velocity, Vp? 1500 meters per second, right? About that, right? So here, 1500 is around this part, right? So when the degree of saturation is, it has to be very close to 1, right? Then you get the wave velocity, pH velocity of the soil larger than 1500 meters per second. So good thing about the pH velocity is that you can use this wave velocity as an indication of the full saturation. So also there are correlation between the B value and the pH velocity. Do you know what the B value is? B value, Kiran, do you know? B value? We'll talk about that soon. So as soon as like you have 1% air, well, 0.1% air volume, then the pH velocity drops to, how much is it? This is 100, 200, 300, so around 300 meters per second, right? 질문 있나요? Okay, then let's move on. Oh, here, I think this is a good example. So when you look at this trial cell here, I think I found this paper like last week, and this has very, I think I call it very smart. And you have a conventional trial setup, and you have a P wave accelerometer. So this is axial movement. It captures the axial movement, and also you have a P wave accelerometer that's for axial movement. And you have a S-wave accelerometer that captures the torsional deformation, displacement. So when you have vertical impact to the top cap, that impact will go through the this cap, the top cap, and through the specimen and to the bottom cap, right? And if you pick up the wave arrival of the P-wave at this sensor and this sensor, then that interval will be the travel time for P-wave, right? So from there you can calculate the P-wave velocity. And what about torsional? So to measure the S-wave, they generate the torsional excitation. And here they had another bar, the horizontal bar, and I think that they hit it with the sudden to generate the sudden impact. Then it generates the torsional excitation, and then this wave will transfer and propagate through the soil, and then you get the acquired signal at each accelerometer. Right? I think that because of the location, I think you have to subtract the value for this distance of the steel plate. Right? But anyway, from the calibration, you can get the S wave velocity and the P wave velocity. Right? So it's a very good setup. And they got the P wave velocity like this, and the shear wave velocity like this, and it's been plotted against the B value, and B value is defined as Youngman. What's the definition of the B value? What is it? 동화 있니? 응. So change in pore pressure caused by increase in confining stress. Right? So delta U over delta sigma C. So to measure the, so how we measure the B value? You increase the water pressure around the specimen here by increasing the confining stress. You apply the delta sigma C, and you measure the pore pressure inside the soil. That will be delta U. So when the B value approaches to 1, I think larger than 0.9, 90%, then people assume that maybe 95% people assume that it's a fully saturated condition. So as we go to right side here, soil gets more saturated. And as you go this side, you have less saturated. So B value 0 doesn't mean you have perfectly dry soil. You can have the 0 B value when unsaturated case. Right? So it doesn't always correlate like that. So, but this indicates the full saturation when you have the B value of 1. So as the saturation increases, shear wave doesn't change. But P wave velocity increases very fast, and it goes to above the 1500 meter per second. So 1500 meter per second is what? The velocity of the water, right? So then you can say that you have the fully saturated condition. Right? And another is the more compiled data, and you can see that S wave doesn't change with the saturation that much. It's quite flat. And you have the wave velocity of the P mode that increases above the 1500 meter per second. I think this is very interesting. You see that the when the P value is around 80%, so 0.8, you have the P wave velocity larger than 1500 meter per second. Here also it varies very much. Range of this. Okay, question? 여기까지. Comment? Okay, then let's look at the velocity and the attenuation together. So, this is a result of the sandstone. It's not the soil. And extensional mode is like the rod wave velocity. This is the shear wave velocity. And what do we see? In terms of the velocity, as the saturation increases, shear velocity stays constant and a little bit decreasing. Right? Why? Why decrease? Because you have increase in density. Shear stiffness didn't change much because it's rock. Capillarity will be very small, so you can ignore the capillary pressure. So you don't have any change in shear modulus, but you have change in inertial force, inertial mass. So you have change in density. So you have, that's why you have a decrease in shear velocity. Okay? What about here? You also have decrease in P wave velocity because modulus doesn't change, but density increases. But at certain point, close to 100% saturation, you have increase in P wave velocity because now you don't have any air. Fluid work modulus increased at, suddenly increased at the, right, close to 100%. Right? So very classic response of the wave velocity of the rock according to, with respect to water saturation. So I hope you can see this similar result of this one. And what about the attenuation here? Extensional mode, so it's, you can think, you can also compare with the P wave. And attenuation increases as the saturation increases. Right? And at some point, you have sudden decrease to here. Right? In the initial P wave attenuation, is larger than the S wave attenuation. So this is perfectly dry condition. Right? And in dry condition, shear wave actually, you have very small attenuation. And perfectly saturated condition is reversed. So attenuation of the S wave mode is larger than the P wave mode. We'll talk about it soon, the reason of that. And okay, then why we have increasing attenuation in this P wave mode or the extensional mode? 왜 증가할까? 모르겠니? 왜 증가할까? What causes the attenuation, P wave attenuation? P 웨이브 어텐유에이션이 뭘로 생기지? 뭐 때문에? 성윤? 정성윤? 정성윤 여기구나. 저기가 누구지? 저기가? 네. 어? 아, 강석준. 석준. 왜? 혹시 뭐가 P 웨이브 어텐유에이션을 만들죠? 매그너스. Do you recall anything? Chapter 7에서 얘기했는데. So as you have more water, you have, when you have a compression of wave coming, then the water can squeeze out, water can flow from high pressures, pressurized zone to lower pressurized zone, right? Because of the pressure gradient generated by P wave. So as you squeeze and relax, squeeze, relax, the P wave propagates, right? And as it propagates, because of the squeezing motion, the water can flow to the perpendicular direction. And if you have more water, then you have more mass to move. So then you have more energy dissipated, right? Energy load. So you have increasing attenuation. Then why it suddenly drops? And also you have another things here. Compression of the air. When you have a compression of the air, adiabatic compression generates the heat. So the heat can also contribute to the energy loss, right? But here, as you go to 100% full saturation, because it's fully saturated condition, you don't have any fluid flow. The water is filling the adjacent next pore, is blocking the one wants to move, right? If there's a water wants to move, squeezed out, because of the already that you have the pore filled with water, so this water cannot move, right? So then you have no fluid flow. So that's why you have sudden decrease in this attenuation. And here it's a little bit different. You have a torsional shear, right? Torsional shear, you have water, and as you get more water, this shear movement can generate also water flow, so that at the saturated condition, because of the fluid flow, you have increasing attenuation. Because the motion is different. So here you have only compression, and here you have a torsional move. So this paper is very classic paper. They are written by Murphy. So please read it and then make it yours. So P wave attenuation, that as saturation increases, attenuation increase because of the fluid flow and compression of the gaseous phase and movement of the droplet. But it starts to decrease when the saturation increases above the 80%. So you get the value 1 over Q. So 1000 over Q is about 40. So then that's 2D. So that's about like 0.2%, right? 0.2% here, like 0.08%, right? Less than 1%. So you can compare the 1 over inverse Q to the damping ratio. Okay, S-wave velocity. This is a classical data obtained by Professor Zhou, right? I think he showed this data a lot in the Soyuzhen waves class. Right? You have a S-wave velocity with respect to water saturation. Here is the zero and 100%. So basically, he started from the fully saturated condition. He has the soil compacted in the cell, and in this cell there was a lot of hole, so that you can have the homogeneous drying process. And then he put the soil specimen inside the oven, and he take it out and measure the wave velocity, take it out and then put it in another oven again, and then measure it and keep the drying process, and then as he dries the specimen, he measures the wave velocity using the Bender element. And so he started from 100%, and then you have increase in wave velocity a little bit. And why? Capillarity, right? And then here you have sudden increase. It's a very considerable increase, and then it drops. So at the maximum wave velocity, you had the highest capillary pressure that increased the effective stress of the soil. So it's like you're building a sandcastle using the water. So this is clean glass bead, and here you have kaolinite and 80% glass bead. This shows it doesn't show any drop, right? Why? Kept increased to 1,000 meters per second. Wow, this is really high velocity value, 1,000 meters per second. So when you have a kaolinite and when you dry, I think if you dry the clay, you experience the same thing. It becomes very stiff, right? It becomes almost like rock, and you have to break it with your hand, right? And this kaolinite makes a bridge between the grain at the grain contact, and that increases the shear stiffness of the soil, actually acting as a cementation effect. Sand boils, I think he didn't wash it, so he just used the natural water content inside. He didn't wash, he didn't rinse the soil. So when he did that, when he dried the specimen, it didn't drop also either, because there was a salt inside, and the salt got precipitated, and it cemented the grains, increased the skeletal stiffness. I can show you the picture. So SA velocity, sorry, the main essence of the SA velocity, it reflects the shear stiffness, right? Shear stiffness of soil, and when you have a capillary force very large, that larger than the effective stress, then you can also capture the capillary force and capillary pressure by the shear velocity. Salt precipitation and clay buttress formation at the contact. I'll show you the picture. So this is the clean glass bead, and as you dry, you can see that the meniscus moves, right? And this meniscus becomes small. Before, you have to look at the radius. You have a radius of this much, right? R, and capillary pressure is inversely proportional to this radius. So as you have smaller radius, you have a higher capillarity. And here you have a decreasing radius of the meniscus, and also you have very small radius. So as you have very smaller radius of the meniscus, you have a higher capillary pressure. So that's why you had this increasing shear wave velocity, right, before it drops. And the glass bead and the kaolinite mixture, you can see that I didn't include this slide in your handout. I can post it later. You have drying process is continuous, and at some point you have removal of the water, and you have a clay got precipitated, or there's making a bridge between the grains here. So this is the grain, and you have a clay like this. So this is the grain, sand grain, and you have a clay like this, right? So you can see that this big particle, this is the sand particle. You can see that this is the clay part, right? So clay is making a bridge, and it calls a buttress, that strengthening the soil stiffness. Salty water, when you dry it, you have this kind of a salt precipitation at the grain contact, and that's why you didn't have any drop at the perfectly dry condition. So I think this would happen in this case, right? Salt precipitation. Interesting, right? And this picture is, I think it's really gorgeous picture. 퀘스천? 질문이니? 신규 용민 질문이 있었던 것 같은데. Okay. So then, let's summarize for this attenuation. When you have, if you remember the Murphy's experiment with the sandstone, at the fully saturated condition, 1 over Q, the attenuation value for the P wave was less than the S wave, right? Because you didn't have any fluid flow. The S wave, fluid flow can occur because the shear wave can cause the compression in some region and dilation, and that enhance the fluid flow like this, as it says here. So when the, you can see this one. At fully saturated condition, shear wave damping is larger than the P wave damping. In general, P wave damping is what? Less than the one-third of the shear damping. And in unsaturated media, the high compressibility of the gas-water mixture enhances the fluid flow mechanism in the compressional mode. So it's like it's squirt flow. And as we said, the local flow and the compression of the gaseous phase that cause the attenuation. And dp increases and the s increases with, so that d at unsaturated condition, p wave damping is larger than the s wave damping. So this actually summarizes the previous study by Murphy here. Okay. 질문이니? Degree of the effect of the degree of saturation에 대해서. 그래서 프로젝트를 하면서 비슷한 걸볼수 있으면 좋겠어요. So the next topic is the effect of stress and the porosity. When you have continuum media, it's like solid media, the effect of stress has very small effect. So the minimal effect on the stiffness. The stiffness won't change much as you confine it. But in particulate material, because the particle can just behave, or they can move independently, as you confine more, you have higher stiffness. So that's why you have depth-dependent stiffness in the soil. So here, shear wave can capture the state of stress at any degree of saturation, and P wave can capture the state of stress in the unsaturated condition. Why? In fully saturated condition, bulk modulus of the water governs all the overall stiffness, so that the effect of confining stress doesn't change the constraint modulus of the overall soil. When you have a fully saturated soil, water bulk modulus that governs everything. Okay. So in unsaturated case, the PA velocity become lower, like 300 meter per second and 500 meter per second, right? At that point, you can increase the confining stress, then you'll see the difference. Velocity, so the velocity and stress relationship for granular media under isotropic loading can be expressed and can be captured by this expression. And actually, this power law is generalized from the Hertzian contact. Theory. Right? So you remember the E tangent was a function of the stress or some exponent, right? So beta exponent and something like that, right? So this power law was the motive or the basis of this expression. And here the alpha is alpha, we call it alpha coefficient, and beta exponent, and sigma naught prime is the isotropic effective stress. Right? You see this if, this expression a lot. So, for example, when you measure the shear velocity with increasing the vertical stress, then you have increasing shear velocity like this, following the power law, and here the beta can be found from like least square, LLS, least square solution, LSS, least square solution. If you fit it, you can extract this alpha and beta coefficient. And what does alpha means? Alpha means the velocity at 1 kilopascal. Right? So if you put the 1 kilopascal to this sigma naught prime, then you have just, you can cancel this term, so you have only alpha left. So the alpha indicates the wave velocity at very low stress. So this is going to be the next project. Then we're going to explore what the physical meaning of the alpha and the beta parameters. And let's look at the beta first. And beta exponent captures the contact effect and the fabric change. Contact effect. When you have perfectly solid material, then the stiffness doesn't change with the confining stress, right? So then beta is ideally, it's going to be zero. So then it doesn't matter with the stress state. No matter you have a high stress or low stress, velocity wouldn't change. But so if we use the analogy for the real soil or the rock, if you have very cemented soil, because it's already cemented, if you apply the stiffness, if you increase the confining stress, the wave velocity change will be small compared to the non-cemented soil. Right? Or the rock is also another case. Right? When you have a rock, the stress change wouldn't change for the wave velocity. Right? The relative change will be smaller, less than the soil. So over-consolidated clay is the same, because over-consolidated clay already experienced the pre-consolidation stress, so that it has very stiff, initial stiffness very large. And Hertzian contact is, if you remember that, it's about 1 over 6 is the Hertzian contact when beta is 0. Also, sorry, when you have a two sphere like this, and you apply the normal stress, then the Hertzian contact theory gives you the beta value of 1 over 6, that's about 0.167. Then this reflects the rounded smooth particle at elastic contact. And when you have beta exponent about 1 over 4, the quarter, or 0.25, you have loose end, angular end, and this gives you, this is about, you have a cone and plate interaction. So 1 over 4, you can theoretically derive this exponent value assuming that cone to plane contact. So then this cone shape can represent the very angular shape of the sand. If you have an angular shape of the soil, then this you will have a higher beta than the round soil. So round soil, you have smaller beta. Angular soil, you have a higher beta. And when you have contact yield, so this one above, when you have a 1 over 6 exponent, we assume the elastic contact. But at some point, as you increase the stress, the contact, the material will yield. It will go to plastic stage. Then beta becomes 1 over 4. So here, your contact yield. And when you have a Coulombian force or the van der Waals force interaction, then this beta value, you have a two sphere like this, and when there is an electrical force, force 0 over 4. So just remember this. As soon as electrical force interaction begins to gain relevance, then you have increasing beta. If you have only pure mechanical interaction without electrical force, then the beta will remain like low, like less than quarter, maybe. So electrical force means what? You have clay mineral, right? If you have more clay mineral, when you apply the stress, that the particle to particle interaction will have electrical interaction on the top of the mechanical interaction. So when you have electrical interaction, the beta will increase. So that soft clay, you have a 0.3 value. This is what I was going to say. The beta increases with more electrical interaction. 질문.
OC 클레이에서는 거기에서도 이게 너무 이게 클레이 입자가 너무 가까우니까 거기서도 일렉트리컬 포스가 작용할 수 있는데 그때는 왜
베타가? Good question. In OC clay, why you have low beta exponent? Because it feels like it's already cemented soil. Cementation 이제 initial stiffness is very large, so we'll see that effect too. Okay, let me go back to this one. Okay. So this is unconsolidated soil or normally consolidated clay. You have increasing shear velocity like this, right? But if you have over-consolidated clay, the initial shear velocity is around here. It's going to be very large. And it increases like this. And this slope means the beta. If you have a large slope, then you have a high beta. So because of the high initial wear velocity at low stress, at the OC clay, you have low beta. Okay, so then this experiment is very simple and a fundamental experiment. You have you have 15 plastic particle. So you have particle 1 to 15, and you apply the stress, and there was a piezo sensor, here the wave sensor, and another piezo sensor captures the arrived wave. Right? Here, as you increase the stress, they measure the velocity, and when they increase the stress, the wave velocity first increases according to this beta value 1 over 6. And at some point, that the grain-to-grain contact gives you the plastic yield, then the beta increased to 1 over 4, quarter. That was the same that we did for what? This one, right? Here, we had a quarter for contact yield. And here, oh, sorry. The Hertzian contact. For elastic contact, 1 over 6, and 1 over 4 for the plastic contact. So at the low stress region, before the contact yielding, you have a 1 over 6 value for the beta. And once it's yielded, then you have a quarter for the beta value. Very neat experiment, right? using only like 15 plastic particles. Then he did the experiment. Also, it didn't show you the experimental test, but he did with the spherical contact and the rusted steel bearing. And when you have rough value, rough particle and the rusted particle, you had the higher beta. Okay. Another experiment is that they had the plastic particle packed as simple cubic packing. So simple cubic packing is, you know what the simple cubic packing is, right? So it has the packing like this in 3D. Right? So you have a 12, 12, 12 particles, a total of 1,000, over 1,000 particle. And first, they relax so they decrease the x-axis here, right? X-axis. They decrease the stress at the x direction. So basically, they move the wall outside the soil packing. By doing that, they decrease the stress. And then they reloaded their lateral movement, so lateral stress. So they moved the wall to the original position. And then they unloaded it. So they did their unloading, reloading, and unloading. And while the Z and the X, so the other direction stress was remain constant. So then this is the result. So first, when they reloaded it, so they did this procedure one. Here, the beta is about 0.04. And then, when you start having the grain-to-grain contact, then you have increase in beta to 0.3. And when you had the constant fabric, it decreased to elastic contact theory. So this is the condition that you had. Like this, so it didn't touch the other particle, and here it starts to touching particle, right? But as you increase the stress, the particle move, so you have particle movement and rearrangement of the particle so that the fabric still changes this region. At this region, right? And when it comes to the original position, aligned as a simple cubic packing, so then now you have only the elastic deformation between the particle at the particle contact. So then it follows the Hertzian contact theory. And this is the case you have unloading cycle. You have unloading cycle, and then when it retouching it, detaching, when the particles start detaching, then you have very less value, the small value of the beta. But here is the reloading, changing contact behavior and fabric, constant fabric, and the fabric breaks. And this slide shows the photoelastic figure during this wall movement. So initially it's a simple cubic packing and you have vertical load and the lateral force, right? A vertical force and the lateral force. So you have a principal stress at the particle. So you have one principal stress and another principal stress at the particle, right? And now here the wall is moving this direction. So then at the contact, now your principal stress in this particle is rotating. You don't have the vertical and the horizontal stress plane as a principal stress plane anymore. So you have a rotation. And when you apply the lateral wall, lateral force again to move this particle back to the original position, then you have also the large distortion at this grain to grain contact, the principal stress plane, principal stress and the principal planes are now rotating. And sorry, now when you still keep increasing the PL, you have horizontal stress and the vertical stress recovered. So actually this shows the fabric change and the stress distribution, and this compares to the this velocity and the stress graphs. So beta parameter shows the grain to grain contact behavior, and also it shows the fabric change. It captures the fabric change in soil. So beta tells you very useful information. And the second is alpha parameter, alpha coefficient. And I think we saw this equation before, right? We saw this equation before. And this is the G max, and this V value is what? It's Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio of the grain. And Cn. Cn is what? What is Cn? Cn is coordination number, right? And E is the voids ratio. And G sub G is the grain shear stiffness of grain. And the sigma naught is the isotropic stress, right? And this is from the Hertzian theory, Hertzian Mendelian contact theory. And you can see that this can be the, what? This is the correlate to the beta. 2 beta is 1 over 3. Why? Vs is square root of g over rho. So when you put the g max to here, then you have a square root, so that you get the beta as 1 over 6, right? According to Hertzian theory. But rest of them is the alpha parameter then. Then alpha is function of void ratio and coordination number and grain property, shear stiffness of grain and the Poisson's ratio of grain, right? So then, this void ratio tells you the density or the how well packed or the relative density of the soil, right? Packing and porosity. And coordination also correlates with the void ratio. And when you have a stiff grain, for example, you have a rubber particle and you have a steel particle, then stiffness will be very different, right? And rubber gives you small g sub g. And what is it? Steel will give you high shear stiffness of grain. Then alpha will be different. Alpha of steel particle will be larger than the rubber particle, according to this equation. So here again, stiff particle, then you have, so what does alpha mean? Alpha is velocity at isotropic stress of 1 kilopascal. Right? Essentially, you don't have any effective stress in this case. 1 kilopascal is very small. The atmospheric pressure is 100 kilopascal, right? It's a hundredth of it. So, when you have a stiff particle, like steel shot versus rubber, if you have a steel shot, you have high velocity at 1 kilopascal, So you have high alpha. And density. High density. If density increases, void ratio decreases, and coordination number increases. So then, initial velocity at low stress regime also increases. So you have high alpha. What about the cemented soil? If you compare with the non-cemented soil, your velocity will increase with the cementation strength, right? So then you have high alpha. Then there is a relationship, so it's an empirical relation between the beta and the alpha, and it's about the linear relationship, the 0.36 minus alpha over 700. So if you have a denser packing, you have decrease in beta, but increase in alpha. Okay. So here, if you look at the graph, where is the relative density of 9? So this is very loosely packed soil, right? Relative density is low. So this one here. And highest relative density, 80%, 88%. Here is one here. So why is that? Densely packed soil gives you the initial velocity, high initial velocity, but because it's already densely packed, if you increase the stress, the increment of the velocity is less than when you have loosely packed soil. Loose packed soil, initial velocity is low, but if you increase the stress, it can be stiffer more. Right? So the potential to go to high velocity is high in the loosely packed soil. And I think we've done that. And when we look at the clay, as the PI increases, what does it mean? The PI means that you have more plasticity, and plasticity means that you have more electrical force, right? Interaction, so that you have high beta, right? So more plastic soil, you have high beta. And preloading and aging means what? Preloading means that over-consolidated clay, or OCR. If you have a high OCR, then it's been consolidated very much. Aging means that cementation, you have a diagenesis going in inside. Maybe some salt has been precipitated. So aging, as you get older, then you have more cemented soil. Right? So then beta will decrease. So here, increasing PI, soft clay, dense soil, and what else? As your OCR increases, you follow this, this path. Okay. I think it's the same. Beta is high in fine soil, where the double layer effects are more important. And what about the second one? Can you read this through? For loose soil, is beta high or low? 높을까 낮을까? 태요. Low? Loosely packed soil. High, right? High. And for the soil that has been subjected to diagenesis and cementation, over consolidation, beta is low or high? Low, right? Good. Simple. Great. this is another example of inclusion. So you have quartz soil, and quartz is very strong, and you have like very soft particle, mica. So they mix with mica here. So mica has lower stiffness than the sand. So basically, as you increase the, oh, does it show you? As you increase the mica content, you have more soft particle. So as you have more soft particle, alpha will go down. So you have a less slower initial velocity. But you have a higher beta, right? Because as you increase the stress, it can go very, it can have sudden increase or the more drastic increase. So this is a general summary that the photosand particle alpha parameter reflects the grain property and the packing property. So I think many of the researchers suggested this kind of equation. For round particle, you have factor Fe, Boyle ratio factor, that can go into here. For angular particle, you have this value. So when you compare these two, assuming that the other all the parameters are the same, for example, we can assume the Boyle ratio is like 0.6, and the stress is the same, maybe like 100 kilopascal. Which one will give you the higher or the faster shear velocity, round particle or the angular particle? Magnus. Which one will be faster in terms of the velocity? Boyle ratio are the same, effective stress are the same, and A parameters are the same. Then angular or round? If you put the 0.6 to here, the bottom will be the same, and here top Fe will be larger in the angular particle. So if you put it in here, velocity of round particle and the angular particle, if you compare these two, angular will be faster, faster. Thank you. Angular will be faster. Good. For the clay, NC, when you have the normally consolidated clay, as you increase the isotropic stress, void ratio also decreases, right? And for the clay, actually, because it's soft clay, you also have the fabric change. As you increase the loading, it gets compressed, so then you have change in fabric. And this change in fabric can be captured by this alpha, and higher velocity changes with stress changes in the more compressible soil, a higher compressibility, and higher exponent beta. And Boyle ratio are not recovered during unloading. Stiffness during unloading is determined by the maximum past pressure. So this is a pre-consolidation stress. So then pre-load ratio or the OCR can be incorporated into this equation so that you have, instead of the alpha parameter, you have A and you have beta for the stress term, and you have a OCR value in the equation. And this beta and the M exponents are the different. So medium to stiff kaolinite specimen, beta is about 0.25. And soft bentonite specimen, you have 0.5. Because it has high electrical force and it has high compressibility comparing to the kaolinite. Bentonite is made of momoinonite.